What are we supposed to do with the information? It might stress us. It might make us more depressed. I mean, it's...
Well, now you're talking like a bioethicist, in fact. They will come out and say, consumer genetics is a bad thing because people cannot deal with this kind of information. All they get is sort of a risk profile with percentages, and it will only make them nervous. They will focus on all these diseases that they probably won't get, most of them, and it will only be bad, so please ban it. They've banned it in Germany, for example. What I would say is that if you look at the studies that are being done by social scientists on how people actually react in real life, they don't get more nervous. In fact, even the people who have, you know, who get the knowledge that they have a really high risk, genetic risk of Alzheimer's disease, which you can't cure or can't prevent, even they, after an initial period of, you know, depression, will come out and say, I appreciate having this information.
Because we can change the
lifestyle. Because I can change my life. I can, you know, think about this. If you don't have information, how can you act?
I think it's a little patronizing to remove information.
Yeah, I think so too. I think this, I mean, this is a kind of information that it's in our bodies. Mm. It's ours.
So what have you felt after receiving this information?
You know, I'm a bit strange. So I've always gathered data. I'm fascinated by that. So, like, I'll tell you already right now, I got a certain scale at home that I do every morning, every night, so where it records my body fat and weight, and it sends it to the internet, and I store that. And I take pictures of the food that I eat and actually store that too so that I can figure out how it actually affects my body. So, I'm on the scale of like more information, probably information overload scale, which probably not a lot of people.
Excuse me, you are you, so you take a picture before you eat?
Mm-hmm.
And...
Yeah, I've tried to, you know, work with software to try to figure out what the food is and the contents of it so that I know whether it's healthy or not.
But are you extremely fit?
No, obviously
no,
not.
No, but I wonder if, is it all muscles?
I wish, but no.
Because most of the time people who are extremely fit might be, you know, a bit...
Yeah, I probably got that too, but
you got this. But not,
I missed the getting fit part.
I don't mean to be rude. I was just very curious.
No,
look, you believe that in a few years we will all do this?
I think in say 15 years, perhaps, a lot of children, newborns in the West, will just have, you know, their genome sequence from one end to the other, and the information downloaded onto, you know, a hard disk somewhere.
But what if this information, which is highly sensitive, very private information, ends up in the wrong hands?
Well,
like the insurance companies, yeah. Yes, yeah. Insurance companies, or Facebook, or Spotify, or whatever. Yeah. I mean.
Well, about dangerous. Insurance companies, which, of course, is an interesting point. In the U.S., they have a law against, it's called GINA, it's a law against genetic discrimination. So insurance companies cannot ask for or use genetic information from people. Employers cannot ask for or use genetic information. And I think within the EU and, you know, our single countries, we should be thinking about these laws because we don't have a full picture of where could this information be in the wrong hands? On the other hand, we have an extremely interesting development, which is sort of, I mean, probably right up your alley as well, which is called open source genomics. People who have their whole genomes sequenced or have a genome profile done and just upload it onto the web with their names and their health information to create a sort of, you know, accessible database that everyone can go into.
Having adopted kids from Ethiopia, you will always have to guess.
Yes, I always have to guess because I can't see any resemblance at all, which I think is a good thing. When I couldn't get children, I was thinking that, oh my God, I'm not going to see how my kid is going to look like, the inheritance, I'm not going to see anything. And I thought, I think that also can be a very good thing to not know, because there's a lot of things going on in my family as well that I don't want to inherit at all. So we couldn't know what we will get, what kind of a child we would get. So we are starting fresh and just experience these kids and saying, okay, that's nice, that's not so nice.
one last question, Lone. Are we our genes entirely?
Well, the short answer is no. We are not. I mean, that's a lot of people, it's a great big mistake out there that, you know, that genetics have to do with determinism, that we are determined by our genes. It's like, you know, people see them as a prison almost. Our biology is not a prison. You know, it's something to be, it's a malleable thing. And the wonderful thing about our genome is that it's reinterpreted in our cells all the time. The information may be the same all your life, but genes are turned on and off, you know, as a reaction to your environment, what you do to yourself, what you eat, what you read, which movies you watch. Our genome is not a straitjacket. It's a nice, warm sweater that you can sort of
a nice,
know, shape
warm
and form.
Sweater, I see. Mm. Thank you so much for coming here and telling us about Taxodar. And thank you, Sir Ben Kingsley.
Pleasure.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Dere, vi ses her i studio neste fredag med blant andre Lionel Richie i studio, men nå med sin første single, ta imot Lone Frank.